So how did you become the master of the pastor?
Yes, very good question. By accident, and like most things in life, I sort of stumbled into this world. I'd previously worked on movies, and in fact, when I started writing, which is of course in prehistoric times, I would never have dreamt of working in TV. Hmm. It was very low, you know. It was very cheap. It was low. Production values were very bad. Everyone aspired to work in movies. That was where the money and the glamour were and everything. And it was after I'd done Elizabeth, and I was approached by a young American TV executive, Ben Silverman, who said, would I consider turning the Tudor dynasty into a kind of soap opera, TV soap opera? So I said, no, that's sort of ridiculous. But he persevered. We had an extremely long lunch that sort of went into the evening. And then at the end of it, I said, well, I still don't quite understand, in a sense, what you're talking about or what you're expecting or kind of what level you're talking about. I mean, do you expect the material to be dumbed down in some ways? Will you send me some shows, TV shows, that you like, that I could see the standard of? He said, sure, I'll send you lots of DVDs. He sent me lots of DVDs, and they were all episodes from The West Wing. And I kind of got it. I got the fact he was telling me, look, you can be, it's got to be entertaining, but it can be serious.
Well, I'm guessing he saw something in Elizabeth that struck him. I mean, it's not a soap opera. It's a beautiful movie, but it's not. There's something personal, intimate, and not kind of overly glorious about it.
Yeah, and it's not. It's not a museum piece.
Yeah,
you know, it connected the issues from Elizabeth's life with things that women particularly care about now. And, and she was like a young woman who was made head of the company, and it was really difficult, you know. So I said yes, without knowing whether I could write continuous drama, you know, and I've never done it before. And then I found out that I loved it. I mean, I loved the ability, the opportunity to develop characters. In movies, characters are revealed. In series drama, they're explored, developed. They can change. They can, you know, they can suddenly jump out of the box and behave in different ways. And as a writer, you're on for the ride. It's wonderful, you know, and I get to like and love these, a lot of these characters.
So is it any different, and maybe you don't know because you haven't really done it, but is it any different than doing hour-long television, you know, like a regular network series? I mean, Tudors is for Showtime, it was international sales, it was all over the place, but it was, you know, it was much more, was there a chance to kind of write the arc and live the arc before you got into production, or were you doing it weekly, or...?
I was doing it, at least it was only me doing it, so I wrote all the episodes. But I didn't know that they'd take it more than one season. You know, there was no guarantee that it was going to work, because it was about men in tights, you know, and apparently at the time
really
in America,
good-looking men in tights.
Very good-looking men in tights, that helped a lot. But there was no apparent appetite in, you know, mid-America, across America, for historically based material. Right. I mean, now it's everywhere. You know, it's been a revolution. But at that time, Showtime took a big leap of faith. And so for me, I had to think about the arc of the first season. I had to think about how I was going to tell this story about an English monarch and his queen to make it resonate with Americans and American, you know, people in the Midwest and so on, you know.
So what do you think about people in the Midwest? I mean, did you actually think about that?
Yeah, I actually thought about, because I know that there was a constituency which was kind of, you know, East Coast, on the fringes, East Coast, West Coast, intellectuals, bright people, people interested in history, literature, and they would watch BBC drama. But that wasn't the market. That, you know, the commercial, that was a small little niche. And we wanted, I wanted, you know, as big a market, as big an audience as we could get. And to reach across to these people, I had to find ways of making the past relevant to the present. So that was my, you know, issue. And similarly with Vikings. I mean, you know, that Vikings is a family saga. You know, it's about a guy who loves his wife and his kids, you know, and has problems with his brother and his boss.
Yeah.
You know, so, but it's rooted in real history, in, you know, with real people. But that's my function. That's what I do.
So going back even before Elizabeth, was your interest in this kind of stuff? I mean, you did indie films that were not really historic dramas. You did.
Yeah.
Other things. I mean, were you steeped in history as a kid? Or is it something you became
interested
in? Yeah,
well, the only two things I could do at school, apart from sport, were history and English. So I cunningly contrived to make a career out of combining them. But I was in universities for a long time, like 10 years. And I thought I was going to be an academic. That was my trajectory. Mm. And I met a film director who persuaded me to write a screenplay for him. But being, you know, having been an academic for so long, part of the joy for me is the research, the initial, you know, finding a period that's interesting and dramatic, then plunging into the books, finding the stories, finding the characters, trying to hear their voices. It's very important, you know, that all these, you can't, like in Elizabeth, I couldn't obviously reproduce Elizabethan English because no one would understand it. But I didn't want it to sound completely contemporary. Mm-hmm. So I had to find a language, a way, a music, a way of kind of making it sound, well, okay, it's not modern, but it's, you know, it's not totally museum piece period.
And unlike Hugh Hudson, Chakar did not hire Al Pacino, so that probably helped a little bit.
Well, we hire, because these are Canadian Irish co-productions, we have to hire some Canadian actors and all the cast has got, we have Scandinavians, we have Brits, we have Irish people. They've all got to sound roughly the same. Mm-hmm. And so we work on that. We find a base level where everyone's comfortable. Because I hate those. There used to be these Euro puddings. I don't know if you ever saw them. There's
many, you know, of them.
And everyone spoke in completely different accents. Yeah. It was horrible. You know.
Tim Blake Nelson did a movie called The Gray Zone where they decided that everybody would speak in their real accent. So it was, you know, that just was the theme of it. It was set in a concentration camp. And so, you know, Mira Sorvino spoke like Mira Sorvino, everybody, except for Harvey Keitel. Who had worked on the German accent and decided he was going to do that German accent no matter what. So you have Harvey Keitel doing this bizarre German accent and everybody else speaking, you know, whatever language and voice they spoke in. It was a little scary.
But he's such a great actor.
Yeah. So, I mean, in this case, I guess it wasn't so surprising seeing your first head of operations, Gabriel Byrne. But when Donald Logue shows up, it's like, oh, okay. Where did that come from?
Yeah.
I mean, he's terrific, but it's like, he's not the guy you would think of as a period costume drama guy.
But that's what's good about it. I mean, one of the things I'm trying to do with the Vikings, a little bit with the Tudors, was to challenge conventions and cliches. Of course, you mentioned the Vikings. Everyone thinks they know who the Vikings were and what the Vikings were, and it's full of cliches. You know, they wore horned helmets and raped and pillaged for no particular reason, and shouted Odin sometimes also for no particular reason, and so I wanted obviously to do them justice, to actually look into Viking culture, which is fascinating.
You didn't just want to hire the entire Skarsgård family and we're let trying them have at it.
We are trying to hire the entire Skarsgård family. I mean, it's great to have Scandinavians around. You know, I mean, this is their history. It's wonderful. They love it, you know. And I talked to the head of Scandinavian studies at Harvard, who's a Swede, in a radio interview Boston. Well, I was in Oxford, he was in Boston. And I thought he was going to chew me up, spit me out. And he was absolutely complimentary about the show. He said, this is the first time anyone has taken my culture seriously. It's always comic book stuff. You know, I can't believe how faithful you've been or tried to be to our gods, to our culture and things, you know, and it's, so he was wonderful.
So how do you approach it? I mean, obviously you have a bigger story arc for the season, but in each individual episode, I kind of felt like you were moving the story along, but you also were then kind of steeping it in. I assume the story that is not based on one particular story in the history of the Vikings,
It's, well, it's all rooted in this character, Ragnar Lothbrok, and his ascent. And he is a historical character. He was a historical character. He did rise to be king. He was one of the first to raid. We know a certain amount. We know more about him than many of the other Vikings. But around him, I've put other characters, and all of them hopefully have some basis in reality, because that's how I work. I mean, I don't like fantasy. I don't like, you know, just inventing people out of nothing.
But I mean, you have a seer in the back of your pocket.
Well, the Vikings had seers.
Right, but I'm saying, do you?
And they captured priests. So all this is real. I'm just putting it together in narrative form.
But I mean, are you doing the research and finding, you know, okay, this is going to be a great sequence when the time comes? And
sure.
Okay, now I found it. Now I found a way to get that guy in.
Yeah, I start with days and weeks, sometimes months of research and reading and thinking. And I jot things down. So, you know, things that catch my attention, often in the footnotes of the books, because the historians discard these wonderful little characteristic, strange things which I pick up on. I've got scenes that I know I want to work towards, you know, that really pay off the storyline or whatever. But it's, someone here called it, one critic called it old-fashioned storytelling in the best sense. That you know, there are no whistles and bells. You don't quickly cut away to some other reality or character. You are with this story. You are with these characters, and hopefully you learn to like them, if not love them. You know, you're curious about them, and they don't have to be good. In fact, it's better if they're not good. You know, they're more interesting if the lead character's not totally good.
Right.
So I mark my card. I know sort of where I'm going to go to, but I also know that I want to do two things at one time. I want to tell a narrative that's compelling, that's interesting, but I want it also to operate at a different and simultaneously at a different level, which is, as it were, a spiritual level, because I'm really interested in the gods, the Viking gods, the pagan gods, the sagas. And I want people to understand that telling the story from a Viking point of view means you're getting into the Viking's head. And in a Viking's head, these sagas, these gods are real. You know, they actually saw the gods on the battlefield in their lives. I don't do that too much because people would then think it was fantasy, which it's not. It's just a point of view. So, yeah, it's a complex thing. You know, it's narrative in a complex form that looks simple, hopefully, but it's fun for me.
Well, the priest is the kind of the way in, I think, for the audience at first.
Right.
But then he starts, as you get through the season, starts getting challenged in new ways that make him, you know, really, as he evolves into one of them, he becomes as challenged as one of them. But it's an interesting, I mean, but also there are characters that go with that. I mean, the church with the white makeup and everything you know, that's like a new thing. I mean, it makes sense that it was always there and we weren't viewing that because Ragnar was doing other things. But then all of a sudden, that's a pretty big stage piece. That's a, you know, an impactful.
Are you talking about episode 8 with the temple?
Well, the whole temple, yes. And first giving the, you know, splattering the blood and then, you know, actually challenging him and whether he has changed his mind or not.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, by the way, it's my favorite episode. B, I fought like crazy to do it because everyone said, but there are no battles. I said, no, but this is getting into the heart of my idea of paganism. You know, I think this is closer than you'll ever have seen on TV to a pagan ceremony. And of course the Christians borrowed a lot of pagan rituals. So, you know, the director, Ken Girodi, who the Canadian director who shot it, was an altar boy in Canada. And he brought to bear his sense of ritual, you know, and I'm sure that's right. I'm sure that works.
And now the Spanish are being heard from. I don't even know what that was, honestly. Yeah, it was a computer.
The ghost in the machine.
The ghost in the machine. I hope he won't speak again. We'll see. If he does, then we'll briefly stop and fix it, but if not... no, I feel a whole movie coming on. I think the cameraman's going to go fix it. But... Part of that also is it feels almost
this is
like
great though. Okay.
Yes, that's right.
With music,
atmosphere. We need every interview scored by somebody, a live band behind you. But that actually does give a break to the relentless storyline.
Yeah,
you know, you have the full kind of the first six episodes are kind of one specific arc, yeah. even though it's part of the bigger arc.
Yeah.
And you kind of need the break.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost, and it's interesting. It's not yeah. like it's some sort of like, let's stop and feed the baby.
Yeah, yeah, that's you right. know. Yeah, this is where the writer couldn't think of a good storyline.
They just needed to stay at home and smoke cigarettes or something.
Yeah.
Or as Lena Dunham has, she'll have sex in one room for an entire episode.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, you know, gets out and goes back to the show.
Yeah.
But it's it felt like a natural stopping point before he kind of goes on to the next adventure.
Yeah. No, I agree. You know, I just think it's very intense episode. Yeah. I think it's probably the best thing I've written, actually.
So does working for history mean that they are less, oh my God, you need a battle, oh my God, you need a battle? Or are they...
Oh no, they're very keen to have battles. You know, I mean, it's changing, I think, now because of the Vikings, but history's core audience was male.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time before Vikings was slightly older male, and that's what they were looking for. They wanted, you know, I'm switching on something called the Vikings.
Right.
I'd like to see, thank you, some battles and things. We felt we had to be very inventive, mm-hmm. Innovative about the battles and to do them differently each time. There were various rules because it's a network show.
Right.
That was why we needed to be imaginative. The marriage, as it were, between ours and history was perfect. One, because you're at a channel called History, so the audience assume, I think, mm-hmm. that what they're watching has something really to do with history, mm-hmm. and it has, you know. So it gives it that sort of bedrock. It gives them, it's so it's you know, and in other cable shows. It's very rarely to yeah. do with history or reality. So, you know, so that was good. And I don't know, it's just been a great experience. You know, they backed us, they didn't interfere with us, they trusted us. You know, and
it does feel a little like Game of Thrones is taking away all your frontal nudity. You know?
Yeah.
they've packed extra on when you could. But I mean, is it a good thing or a bad thing for you as a writer?
It's a good thing. And I'll tell you why. Because it's gone too far. It's mm-hmm. too gratuitous. I mean, I was accused of that in Tudors, mm-hmm. you know, and I put my hand up and said, look, I was the first season of Tudors, I was looking to get a big audience.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and mind you, in England, people were very cross. They said, well, Henry VIII never had sex. You know, how dare you show? He never had sex. 6 wives. He had hundreds of mistresses. You know, no woman could remain, no maid could remain a virgin in his court, it was said. So, you know, don't be stupid.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But I pushed it, I think, too far. And then it just went crazy after that. And I think, you know, I don't watch Game of Thrones, but people tell me... Okay,
you don't watch Game of Thrones at all?
I don't watch it.
Interesting.
It's fantasy. I don't like fantasy.
That's interesting.
That each episode scene will start with two nearly naked women, and then two guys come in, and the scene starts, you know. And it was like, we're not going to do that, guys. It's that's gratuitous. Not interested in doing that.
Mm.
And more and more actresses were kind of going... Is that necessary to the show? You know, like, so he said, "No, we'll just tell the story. We'll just tell the story."
Well, it's an interesting phenomenon because I think it kind of started with Rome on HBO all those years ago, and it was like it was so extreme that people were actually a little turned off. I think after a while, as beautiful as the ladies were, it was like, you know, enough already.
Yeah,
but it's an interesting.
But it's soft porn, really, isn't it? It's
well, sometimes it turns into that. I mean, that's the thing. I think Game of Thrones actually walks the line pretty effectively for one of those shows that has plenty of nudity and whatever. But, you know, every once in a while in Vikings, I thought, okay, well, they're hanging upside down, bleeding from their necks. Would they be naked or were they wearing their pants? Or, you know, you have love scenes. You have, you know, romantic moments, certainly.
Yeah.
But you have to be more creative than to just rip the bodice off, I guess.
Yeah.
In this case.
Yeah. And I want people to be more interested in what the scenes are about.
Mm-hmm.
Than just watching them, you know, because usually if it's a sex scene or whatever, then there's the reason why it's there, and you know, so it's not a question of using it to titillate or get annoyance. It's part of the storytelling.
And your management of blood is quite beautiful at times. I mean, some of the imagery that you created that in other cases might have just been a, you know, neck dripping or something, really just lovely. I mean, it's blood ultimately, but it's beautiful stuff.
Well, you know, in the sacrifice, in that episode, then it's all about blood. The sacrifices were all about blood. The gods welcomed the sacrifice of blood, which is why, you know, it was carved up warriors who went to Valhalla. And funnily enough, what they did when they got, it was so great going to Odin's Hall in Valhalla, because every day you got armed again, you went into his vast courtyard and you fought, got hacked about again, and every evening you went back into the hall and drank ale with the gods, you know. And so
the ultimate male fantasy.
Yes, what a life.
It is a fun, it is a definitely, there's a, I mean, your film, your show, very strong women.
Yeah.
I mean, considering that the guys are the toughest guys ever, in theory, you know, some of the toughest guys ever, the women are pretty tough, while they're still quite beautiful.
Yeah. No, that was a big thing for me, because I knew there wouldn't be many main female characters, that the ones I had to make their mark. And I knew that from history that Ragnar's wife, Lagertha, had been a famous shield maiden, which is just a woman who'd fought in battle beside him and had a reputation. But she was obviously the mother of his kids. She was his wife. She eventually divorced him. So I thought, I've got material here. This is good. This is a good role. And I didn't realize at all that I was being revolutionary, that there was no one like her on TV. You know, you can be one or the other. You know, but the idea that she's a mother and a wife and a warrior and things, and quite successfully and convincingly. And of course, it was hard to cast.
I would imagine.
Because we were, you know, we were being offered, as it were, we were, that's a very bad way of putting it, but very beautiful actresses, you know. But you looked at them and you thought, have they had two kids? Have they fought in battle? Have they killed people? No. Yeah. I can't make that convincing.
You don't want to go to Xena.
And you don't want to go that way, you know, which is pantomime. So we cast them. I don't know, Catherine Winnick is a black belt in some martial art. And she's totally comfortable being physical. And there are just those great scenes when she's beating Ragnar up, you know, or they're fighting.
Right.
And they're completely convincing. And she's a great character.
And it feels like you actually strip her down as an actress. I don't know what kind of makeup she's wearing, but I mean, she's a beautiful woman, but she looks like she's, particularly in the early episodes, really looks like you made a point of making her look raw and not trying to look beautiful.
We weren't kind. We weren't kind, you know. It was a fairly muted palette, the whole, I think it got slightly richer as we went along. But
her eyebrows started coming in towards the end of the series.
Yeah. We had a Swedish director. In the first three episodes, and he was all for making it as real as it could, and it was going to be greys and blacks, and because we also didn't want to sell the landscape as a holiday destination, you know, so that people are looking at those beautiful mountains and the fjords and say, oh yeah, I'm going to book a cruise next year, you know, so to make it slightly bleak, slightly real, and to invest it with the gods. To make everything possibly symbolic, because the gods were also what were called shape shifters, so they became flies or fleas or birds or ravens or snakes or whatever it was. So whenever you saw something, some animal, it could be something else, you know. So we worked very hard on the look and what we were shooting, and I would say that I think. And I think I'm right in saying that it looks like cinema much more than TV.
And Catherine, very game to
she was
get down to it.
Yeah. No, she was. It was a very difficult thing for her, I think. You know, it was difficult for Jesselyn, too, who'd, you know, who'd been in American soap and TV stuff, which is always shot in two rooms. And, you know, you just... speak as you speak to, so to put her in this wild place with these wild guys and things.
But she does get better lighting.
She does get a bit.
You're glamming her up a lot of the time.
She's the Earl's wife.
Yes.
You know, she's the Earl's wife. She does have a tough time later, I have to say. And, but these women were just, they were strong women. And I thought that was true to life. They would have to be strong women. Most men would die by the age of 30, one thing, reason or another. But I'd say one of the astonishing things that I learned in the research was that the Viking attitude towards women was much more emancipated than it was in England or France at the time. Mm. You know, that women could divorce their husbands, they fought with them, they could own property, they could rule. That's fantastic.
It seems like you can do almost anything as long as you can kick ass and as long as you get your sword behind it.
Yeah, I think, but it was a meritocracy in that way too. Mm. Granted that you had to probably fight people and be strong, but the best rose to the top.
And Floki is kind of he is kind of the jester, and he's also he's kind of the glue that holds together the kind of the spirits of some of these guys. He seems to be more loving, I guess, in a weird way, and more loyal than almost anybody.
Yeah, he loves Ragnar. Lots of people, you know, someone like Ragnar becomes in a very vulnerable position as he rises in power, and thinks there are more people who are interested in betraying him or cutting him down size. But Floki absolutely loves him. But I mean, Skarsgård it's a great character, and he's a great actor. But one of the things he is a pagan fundamentalist, which I think is great. You know, you're a Christian fundamentalist, but here is he hates Christians. You know, he hates the sign of the cross. You know, he's the one, he'll pull down, he'll desecrate altars and things, you know. And he really is convinced that Christ is the, as it were, the Antichrist, that his gods are vastly superior. And of course, paganism went back possibly many thousands of years before Christianity, and Christianity borrowed a lot from them. For example, Odin, who was also the god of curiosity, wanted to know what it felt like to die. So he hanged himself from a tree, and while he was hanging from a tree, someone pierced his side with a spear. Well, I've heard that story somewhere before, you know. So anyway, yes, Floki is... He is a kind of cement in the thing. I mean, he's like an unexpected character. When you think of the Vikings, he's the last kind of type of character you'd think of. But they had gods who were tricksters and jokers, you know. So I thought that was valid as well.
Well, even the more extreme, even the seer and the priest and everybody else, there's a certain humanity and a lack of etherealness to them. I mean, you get a sense of them putting on the makeup and being part of the show and having their rituals and all of that, but you also get a sense of, you know, when he goes to go to the priest when they're first doing the ritual and he's going to, you know, deciding whether to flick the blood or not, that look on his face is every, you know, is every character we've ever seen. It's not some sort of unique... crazy guy.
Yeah. No, that's right. That's right.
So when you were a kid, did you ever think that you were going to be making television for the second half of your life? Or making films on television?
No. First of all, I wanted to be a fireman. but I never got the qualifications. And then I wanted to be a soccer player. Mm-hmm. And then I think I wanted to be a journalist. And then because I was at universities, I was going to be an academic. And it was completely the line of least resistance. I didn't have to think about that. And then someone, a British film director, offered me the chance of writing a script. And I suddenly decided that I was bored by academia. And I totally unexpectedly, I mean, I didn't expect it, I jumped. You know, I started to be a writer. But at the same time, I'd always written. I used to write when I was a boy. Little stories, pastiches often, you know. And I think if you're a writer, you can't make yourself become a writer. You just write, you know.
And it sounds like you stayed true to your own proclivities as you've gone through the journey of, you know, working for people.
Yeah, I mean, I've had, you know, God knows, ups and downs and lots of sadnesses and rejections and the rest, you know, things that were made that were awful, frankly. And it's not really that I've been lucky in a way, but I've sort of managed to persuade a few people, not too many, that what I was interested in might be shared by an audience, you know. And but I just write in this way that you know, that it's based on my research, which I love doing, and I build up from there. And as I say now, every other show seems to be a historically based thing, you know. Yeah. But, No, like your tights are everywhere.
The cream rises or something like that.
Well, no. It may be fashion. Who knows? I don't know.
Well, how do you feel an impact of a show like this? Are you paying attention to the web? Or are you reading critics? Or are you just...
I don't do any social networking. I mean, my children do. Mm-hmm. And my co-producer is now in Ireland is now addicted. Gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning and he reads all this Twitter things. And he said, "Michael, we've got 6 million more people." You know, all right. But he said, "Why don't you do this? People love the show. Why don't you share in that?" And I said, "I tell you why. Because I would read all those Twitter messages, and even if they were 99% great, there'd be one person who would post something absolutely horrible." You know, and I would think about that for the rest of the day, maybe the rest of the week, you know, and I don't need that. I don't want that. I want to clear mind. And but I'm not unaware that it's been very successful.
And would the 99% turn your head as well? You've done things that have gotten a lot of praise.
Yeah.
Is that something you have to kind of keep your head away from also?
No, I mean, I'm too old. No,
your ego is well in place. Yeah, it's not really, you know, and
I've got kids and a wife who, you know, cut my head off. You know, I mean and I am never happier, frankly, than when I'm in what my children call my shed in the garden, writing and communing with these characters, and genuinely that's when I'm really happy. So long as I can do that, you know, and paid to do that, that's good enough for me.
You know, Roald Dahl actually had a shed aside from the house.
Yes, I know, it's been preserved.
A famous shed.
Yes, yes.
So maybe you'll get one of your own, you know, little Vikings all over the place, and Tudors, and... Well. Do you feel the urge to go off and make a, you know, American musical comedy, or to do something that's completely outside of the historic genre, or are you just really happy?
You know what, when I think about this, I don't really necessarily see the distinction between historical things and contemporary, because the contemporary is only contemporary very briefly, and next day it's history, you know. So yeah, I'm interested, I'm writing a 60s thing, you know, and that's history. But to me, I mean, I lived through that, so it's not, it's, you know, it's, but it's also still alive and living, part of my personal experience. So I think that to some extent it's a false dichotomy. And what I'm pleased to have done, if I've helped to do this, is to make a lot of Americans more open to this idea that history doesn't just belong in a museum, you know. Because I couldn't believe it for ages and ages that Americans weren't even interested in their own history. And it's like, oh, we don't have a history. What? You know, it's a really interesting history. I mean, I'd love to do more stuff about American history.
Yeah, we don't like to think about it too much.
No, it's funny. Well, hey, you know, Henry Ford said history is bunk. But
well, when things are going well, you just kind of want to, you know, ride the Big Mac or whatever.
Yeah. But the past is still your personal past. Is still part of your present, and your cultural past is still part of the present. So, you know, I can only enrich your life to be aware of that, he said pompously. After half an hour, I do start getting really pompous.
We all do.
Yeah.